Yep.
Fantastic. Thank you, sir. Okay. Well, the bell has been rung, and we've stalled as long as we can. So, as we prepare for our worship service, I just want to start out with so grateful that you all made your way through the floodwaters, the torrents, and got here to worship the Lord.
Amen.
It is always good and right to start with God's Word as we begin our worship service. And every once in a while, I'm looking through the Psalms, seeing what Lord is talking to me to read. And, well, sometimes He tells me to keep going. So this morning, if you will bear with me, you're going to get a little bit more of the Psalms than you might normally get.
Amen.
Psalm 8 spoke to me this morning, and so would you listen to these words as we begin our worship service. The 8th Psalm says this, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the works of your fingers, the moon and the stars, which you have set in place. What is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings, that you care for them. You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet. All flocks and herds, and all the animals of the wilds, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Indeed, how majestic is the name of our Lord, and that is why we're here this morning, isn't it?
Amen.
To worship the only one who is worthy of our worship and our praise. And so let us go to him in prayer as we start this worship service. Father, oh, my Lord and my God and my King, you are indeed majestic. You are the author and creator of all that is. You created us, forming us with your own hands so that we would be in your image and then placed us over all.
Yes.
And so, Father, we gather here this morning to worship you as our creator and as our King. And Lord, where the thoughts of man might interfere, would your Holy Spirit intercede and guide us so that we are focused solely on you?
Yes.
Where we might get distracted, Lord, help us to focus on you. Lord, let this be a time of worship. Let this be a time of adoration. Let this be a time where we acknowledge who you are and whose we are. Mm-hmm. Because we gather here today simply because of the grace and mercy granted to us by your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Yes.
It's in his name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Now, we're going to do something we haven't done in a while.
We are, as you can see, we're going to be accompanied by a cappella today.
Amen.
So please stand, and we're going to sing number 271, Standing on the Promises. And remember what the translation of a cappella is, it's sing loud. So start out when everybody's ready. 271, Standing on the Promises. 271. Ready?
Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises of God, my Savior.
Start. Amen. Take your seats.
Amen.
I don't know when Kathy picked that song, but that second verse, when the howling storms roll in, that was rather timely. Well, good morning, everybody. And again, glad to have you here for our worship service this morning. Just a couple of brief announcements, not many, in fact. First and foremost, if you have your cell phone with you, as always, it would be a rather courteous act if you would at the very least silence it.
Amen.
For those of you who feel the need to use the restrooms, you can either go straight through this door or down the ramp around the back. Restrooms are behind the church. They're unlocked and ready for you, your use should you need them. And also, I just want to reiterate, the church had a wonderful day of worship last Sunday. We had Bill Alston here providing us with music.
Amen.
We had a very successful and smooth church business meeting afterwards, where we have elected a new slate of trustees to help govern the church in a new governance model.
Amen.
And then we had a great fellowship meal. So if you missed out last Sunday, sorry. You got to be here to enjoy what we got. And you came here today, so we'll try to make this as enjoyable as possible.
Amen.
I do want to address up front, this was a tough week on our island with an incident that we never thought we'd see here on Dafuski. The notion that somebody would come and mess up one of our family member just because of the color of her skin is abhorrent to us all. And this service is not going to be about that. And there's a really good reason why this service won't be about that. And the reason is this. When we as the body of Christ focus on Christ,
all right,
that light shines through us into a community. And that's the best way to fight
Amen.
Incidents of hatred, is for us to just burn brighter as Christ burns in and through us. And so if there's any one thing that we as the body can do, it is for us to draw closer to who Christ calls us to be, because that can't help but make a positive impact on our community. And I know that's what Geneva has felt this week. And so let's keep our eyes on Christ. There is evil and hatred in this world. The Bible promises that it will be that way until that final day.
That's right.
So let us just continue to equip ourselves to be the best followers of Christ that we can, and therefore make a difference. And if God chooses to chime in with thunderous notes of applause, and so be it. So having said that, good to have you here. I'm looking around and I see some faces that I haven't seen in here in a while, some faces that I see here all the time.
Amen.
I'm making the assumption that not everybody here knows everybody else. And so let us, as an act of fellowship, as an act of brotherly and sisterly love, let's take the next couple of minutes, get out of your seats, and go and greet somebody else that you were worshiping with here. And I challenge you to get to know the name of somebody you don't know already. So let's gather, shall we?
Okay.
beautiful church. Did everybody get a chance to mingle a little bit, get to know somebody, break down those bonds of fellowship, the barriers to fellowship, get a little wet? All right. Kathy, how did we do with that first song? Did we earn an opportunity to do another one? Okay. Come on up. We're going to do another praise song. Where are we going to go, Kathy?
We're going to go to 435. What a friend we have in Jesus.
That's a good one. Amen. 435.
This is one of Pastor Hayes' favorites. 435.
What's the number?
435. What a friend we have in Jesus. How you stand? Give me a big smile. Let me know you agree with the sentiment.
There you go. God's approval.
Nice.
And that light's just way more. Take your seats again, if you would, please.
Amen.
We have reached that time in our worship service, a time for prayer requests and praise reports and testimonies. John, are you dried off enough? Are you dried off enough? Catherine, how's that towel doing up there? Look at that, my prayer request answered. All right, prayer requests, praise reports, testimonies. Why do I like this time? I like this time because we are called to bear each other's burdens. We are called to lift up each other to the Lord. And the only way we can do that is if we know what's going on in our lives.
Yes.
It is so easy for us to want to put up this all is well facade.
Mm-hmm.
But the reality is, that's not how we are. It's not how we're supposed to be. It's just what we want to portray. The essence of Christian faith is truth.
Mm-hmm.
And that means it's okay to say if something's hurting.
That's right.
It's also okay to boast if something's going really great.
Amen.
And so we are collectively this body called together to live in fellowship with one another, but always lifting up each other to the Lord. And so we have this wonderful time in our worship service. Prayer requests, praise reports, and testimonies. How can we be in prayer for one another? Kathy. Yeah. Okay. Excellent. Okay. Yes, Michelle, how's your mother-in-law doing? Jane, how's Jane doing? Others, yes. So mother and son are doing well.
Amen.
All right. Yes, Ann. You shall have them. All right. Other prayer requests, prayer supports, testimonies. Bill.
Safe passage home.
After church.
All right. Amen. Amen.
Yes. Anyone else? Jeff. Jeff, was that... Did you have something?
I wanted Bill's permission. The men's book reading group gets together on Monday.
Anyone who hasn't been is certainly welcome. We'd love to have you. We won't have read the book that we're going to be talking about, but I think it's going to be a good opportunity. It's at my house. And I'd love to give you an email and I'll put it.
So if you'd like to be a part of that, if you've been wondering, are there any opportunities for men to get together for fellowship on the island? We've been doing a book club for about a year now, and this is, I'm not sure what number book this is, but they've been good books. Yes?
Pray for my girlfriend, Irene Hicks's children. Irene was buried last Friday, and I just pray that her kids will be able to handle her not being able to be with them anymore.
Amen.
Anyone else? All right. Well, it's not a terribly long list this morning. We're a smaller crew anyway.
Amen.
But we're going to lift these prayers up to the Lord as an act of corporate worship. And I would just ask that, as I always do, if the Holy Spirit pricks your heart as one of these prayer requests is lifted up, would you please take that as a sign that you are to take ownership of that prayer request? Take it home with you. And as you have your quiet time with the Lord throughout the balance of this upcoming week, incorporate that prayer request into your daily prayer time. Let's go to the Lord, shall we? Father, we are grateful that you are a God who invites us to lift up our prayers to you because you care about us.
Yes.
And you know what is best for us. And so, Lord, as your body of believers here on Dafusky, we come to you this morning. And, Father, on our heart are those who are struggling with COVID right now, Father. And we just pray that you would drive that out of them. Lord, drive that disease away from us. Help restore these folks to health that they can get back up on their feet. And Lord, we also want to give you praise that Kathy's grandnieces both got engaged the same week. It is a joyful thing to find the mate that you have set aside for us, Father. And so we want to thank you for that. We ask that your arms of comfort would be around Mark and Caroline White. Our pets are like family, and so to have to take one to the vet for that last time is a difficult time. And so we just ask, Lord, that you would comfort them in this time of difficulty.
Yes.
Help them to see you, if at all possible, Father. Lord, we want to give you praise for a grandson born this week, and we rejoice in life, and we are grateful for it. And we thank you that mom is well, that she has recovered well, that future health issues have been spotted and addressed. So, Father, we just pray now that you would hold mom and son tenderly in your arms, that they would never not know your love, what it means to grow up with a purpose.
Yes.
May they rejoice in you always.
Yes.
And, Father, we know that prayer works, and we are grateful for Anne's story this morning about feeling that tug on her heart to call out to you and an answer provided. And we pray, Father, that you would go with her on her trip this Tuesday to see her sister in Baltimore. Would you bless that trip, Father? Would you go with her, keep her safe going and coming? And Father, for all of us who need to get home at the end of this service, make straight our paths and part the waters where necessary, Lord, and help us to get home. And Father, for the family of Irene Hicks, her children who are now dealing with life without their mother, Father, would you just please insert yourselves into their lives, grant them comfort, grant them peace, grant them direction, help them to honor their mother, and help them to honor you. Lord, there are other things in our hearts and minds. We just want to lift them up to you, Father, and ask that you would do whatever you see is best and right for us. Because you are our author and creator, and we are simply your lumps of clay to do with as you wish. So we trust you, and we thank you, and we praise you. In the name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, amen. All right, as we continue with our worship service, it is now time for our scripture reading. And Anne's going to come on up and give us our reading from Hebrews.
Hebrews, the reading this morning is from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 6. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 through 6. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that binds us and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. In your struggle against sin, you have not yet resisted to the point of shedding your blood, and you have forgotten that word of encouragement that addresses you as sons. My son, do not make light of the Lord's discipline, and do not lose heart when he rebukes you, because the Lord disciplines those he loves, and he punishes everyone he accepts as a son. The word of the Lord.
Okay, Ed and Jeff, can I call on you gentlemen to help with the offering this morning? It's our time for the offering. As always, a reminder that we are grateful for whatever it is that God leads you to put in the plate. That's how we operate this church.
Amen.
But also a constant reminder that you have been blessed with offerings that will not fit in this plate, that God really wants you to put to use to the glory of his kingdom.
Yes.
Kathy's going to share with us a little bit of how she has been blessed to bless you in this time of worship. But use this time also as contemplation for how you can be using blessings that God has poured out on you to pour out onto his kingdom and his people. Take it away.
We'll do our best. This is a great song. It's usually associated with the famous Spear Family Gospel Center. It's called Till the Storm Passes By. In the dark of the good night, I have oft hid my face, while the storm howls around me, and there's no hiding place. Midst the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till the storm passes by, till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the
Father God, we thank you for the day. Thank you for allowing us to be here in this rain that's come down upon us. We thank you for the rain that we needed. Lord, bless this offering that we have given back to you as you have commanded us to do, Lord. We ask that you bless it and bless those who give. We thank you, Father, in Jesus' name.
Amen. So all of you had to get in a golf cart this morning, or car, and travel across these rain-soaked roads to get here this morning to worship, but there are some that outdid you, because they had to get into a car to get to a boat to get to the starting point to get here. Oh, did you guys do... What? Stealing his thunder, but he'll have the last word, but well done. Anyway, so... most of you are familiar, my dear friend, brother in Christ, the Reverend Dr. General Hay. He's going to be bringing the word this morning. So, Doctor, it's all yours.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen again.
Amen.
Amen a third time.
Amen.
We do give all honor to the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, which is our guide and our keeper. So we just give God all praise and glory right now, even for all the rain. Even he allowed us to awaken from our beds and started us out on another day journey. We just have to say thank you, Jesus, because we didn't get up by ourselves. I know some may have set an alarm clock, but the alarm clock did not awaken you. You were awakened by the power of God. Amen? Because there were a lot, maybe there were others that set alarm clocks, but they didn't wake this, they didn't awake this morning. So therefore, we give God the praise and all glory for allowing us to be where we are. Thank God for our beloved pastor, Brother Aaron Crosby, and also the first lady in her absence, Sister Jan. I think I see Catherine up there, her first daughter, her second daughter. God bless you, darling. And we just give God praise and glory for all of you who didn't think it was Robert to come out and embrace this weather. Truly, you know, as I was telling someone the other day, they said, well, it was a little rain, and they said, you don't have your umbrella. I said, well, I'm a Baptist. I can stand some more. So therefore, we're going to embrace the water and just give God praise. Thank you, Sister Hay, for your obedience and for coming out here. Just give God praise and glory for you as well. Everyone who in the house this morning, we just give God praise for all of you in your respective positions. Sister Kathy, thank you, Lee, for the scripture. Because without, in other words, we come and we fellowship one with the other because we don't want to forsake the fellowship. You see, the scriptures remind us, let us not forsake the fellowship. In other words, let us not become isolated, but let us become one. And we work together, we fellowship together, one with the other. Now, I don't want to keep you long this morning. Hebrews, the 12th chapter. And we want to read just two verses where it says, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. And that's enough. Our Father, we come before you with thanksgiving. We come thanking you, O God, for this day. We come thanking you for these, your people. And we ask, O God, that you give them their heart desire. Some have come to witness one thing, and some have come to witness another. But whatever it is, O Heavenly Father, we ask, O God, that you just allow them, O God, to be blessed as you would have it to be. Oh, throw your loving arms of protection around them, O God. Give them traveling grace. Give them traveling mercy. Then, O God, I ask right now that you allow me into your storehouse of wisdom. Bring me out on due time. Allow me to speak so loud so that only your people can hear. And then, O God, hide me behind the cross so that only you can be seen. The words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. And the redeemed of the Lord say, Amen.
Amen.
Amen. From that 12th chapter of Hebrews, around that first and second verse, talks about running a race. And we want to speak to you from the sermonic idea. We all have a race to run. We all have a race to run. Just for a subtopic, let us stay in the race no matter what. Now, once upon a time, there was a slogan which read, it matters not whether you win or lose, but how you run the race. Today's world, the motto would read differently. And I quote, it matters whether you win or lose, no matter how you run the race. You see, only a few things seem more important these days than winning. Some of us recall the late Vince Lombardi, Green Bay Packers head coach, once stated that winning isn't everything, it's the only thing. In other words, what he was saying is the desire to win at any cost has far more devastating effects than anything else on our society. Athletes and athletic departments have fallen victim to temptation to use any means to achieve the winning edge over the competition. Sometimes this can mean taking steroids, taking money under the table, having special favors given to them, and special privileges, promises made in order to entice young recruits to sign a contract. You see, everyone wants to be a winner. But remember now, the real winner is the competitor who stays in the race. And we must run the race to the best of our abilities. You see, we all know that winning has more to do with the character and the conduct of the competitor than the outcome. In the final analysis, it is true that what really matters not whether you win or lose, but how you run the race. Now, what's true of the athletic world, my friends, is true to the spiritual world as well. But God is not looking for people with bulging trophy cases. He's looking for people who are willing to do their very best with the talents and gifts they have been blessed with. Just allow me to refer to the 11th chapter of Hebrews. Let me digress just for a little while. It's known as God's Hall of Fame. The people mentioned in this chapter are hardly extraordinary by any standard. One was Abraham, who at 75 years of age decided to leave his homeland on a journey to who knows where. Can you imagine what his neighbors thought or said? Yes, there was Jacob, a man whose life was characterized by deceit. Yes, Joseph, who was despised and rejected by his brothers and yet became Secretary of State over Egypt. And Moses, whose level of self-confidence would qualify him for a course of study in self-empowerment. We could go on and on this morning, but you know what I'm trying to say. You know what I'm talking about. God is not only looking for outstanding people, but God is looking for people who are willing to stand out from the average person and are willing to give the very best of their God-given talents. Now, looking at our text, the Apostle Paul is telling us to run the race of life to the best of our ability. God asks for no more, but he expects no less. Verse 1 links us to the list of people in God's Hall of Fame, so we too can become motivated and have a desire to become real winners in the real race of life. Listen, if you please. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us. Let us run with patience the race that is set before us. In other words, you can be real, you can be a real winner. You can run the race set before you, and you can run it well. The race for the true meaning of life itself, it is important to know that none of us is left alone. But we are surrounded by spectators and sympathetic supporters. None of us runs the race of life in complete isolation. No, no, God has no lone rangers. At times you may feel alone like Elijah did. You may feel as if you are the only one who has stayed in the race and refused to toss in the towel. But God is right there by your side, my friends. For he is like an encouraging coach who gives instruction, offers advice, and more than anything else, simply reminds us by his presence that we are not alone in the race. In addition to God's presence, there is a stadium filled with fans, loved ones, God's saints who have finished life's race and now fill the grandstands to encourage the rest of us. And I believe, my friends, as you run the race of life God has set before you and look with the eyes of faith toward the grandstands. Oh, you'll see all of God's saints waving their arms wildly in your support. That's why the hymnologist could pen the words, how happy are the saints above who once went sorrow in air, but now they taste unmingled love and joy without a tear. Then look what the psalmist says. Said, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord who made the heavens and the earth. Oh, if the race is going to be run well, then we must take off any unnecessary weight. We cannot carry around excess baggage, my friends. Must lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily weighs us down. Oh, you see, every good runner knows that to run well, you must get rid of any unnecessary weight. A good runner at the starting line would not be dressed in a Botany 500 suit looking like Mr. GQ wearing a pair of Stacy Adams. Oh, a good runner not going to be looking like she just stepped out of Vogue magazine. No, but a serious runner is prepared, dressed in appropriate attire, stripped down to his or her shirt, running shorts, and track shoes. In the race of life, every Christian, if they are to run well, must cast off the weights which slows and weighs us down. We must strip off the weights which will impede progress or make the race very difficult to run. Sin is a weight which weighs us down. We need to take it off. We've all sinned. We've all come short of God's glory. None of us are perfect, but we strive for perfection each and every day. And I realize that sometimes our children may sass us, may not do what we have told them to do, but in spite of it all, they are still children, and we must continue to teach and guide them First, my friends, we need to rid ourselves of negativism. Few things hinder Christians more than a critical negative spirit. We've gotten to a point that nothing is positive unless we are the first to think of it. An inability to work with others. It's been said that a man once approached a new minister of his church and said, "Reverend, I just want you to know that I don't like much of what goes on around here. And I will be the first to let you know about it." The minister asked, he said, "Well, why would you want to be so critical?" The man replied, "That's the only talent I have." "Well, if that's the case," said the pastor, "then I have but one suggestion to you, and that is, you recall the parable of the talents where one man buried his talent in the ground." The man said, "Oh yeah, I remember that one." He said, "Well, now you go and do likewise." Secondly, my friends, we need to rid ourselves of our unforgiving spirit. Most Christians seem blind to the harsh effects of unforgiveness. You see, unforgiveness bears on their own progress in the race. Forgiveness is a choice we make. Or you've heard some folks say, "Well, I just can't forgive." But you can. It would just be honest to say, "Well, I refuse to forgive." You see, the cripples in life's race are always those who withhold forgiveness, ones who don't forgive. Too many times in the Lord's house, we hold on to grudges year after year and day after day, but yet we're on our way to heaven anyway. I want you to think about it. And again, my friends, we need to do away with our apathy and our indifferent attitudes. Why, we live in a world where few seem to care about anything. People just care about themselves. They don't care about others. But the scriptures remind you and it reminds me that we got to weep with those that weep and mourn with those who mourn. We need to rejoice with those who rejoice. The church today has far too many team members who seem satisfied just to sit on the bench and not become involved in the race. It's not that they don't have any interest in the game, they simply refuse to become involved. "I don't want to, I don't feel like it." Nevertheless, God, if he didn't feel like waking you up this morning, we wouldn't awaken. God didn't feel like giving you your heart desire, we wouldn't have had it. So therefore, let us understand what we're saying when we say, "Well, I just know I'm okay with what's going on." God wants us to be involved. He wants us to learn of his word. He wants us to love ye one another as he has first loved us, so that men will know that we are his disciples. Oh, to run the race and run it well, we can't give up. Must keep striving onward, not on our own strength, but we need to strive by the outstretched hand of God. But you see, that's what Isaiah was saying when he said God would mount us up with wings of eagles, so that when we walk, so that when we run, we would not become weary. And when we walk, we would not faint. In other words, we would walk in God's love, we'll walk in his spirit, we'll walk in kindness. Oh, he said that those that are patient, they will have their strength renewed just like the eagle. You see, the Greek translates the word patient as enduring, for he that endures the same shall be saved. You're going to have some rough times every now and again, but that's all right. Just continue to hold out until the perfect end. And God has promised that everything is going to be all right. Weeping may endure for a night, but your joy is coming in the morning. Your joy will come in the morning. And when your joy comes in the morning, then you can rejoice. Then you can give God all praise, give God all glory, and say, "Lord, I'm on the battlefield just a little while longer." You see, everyone runs the race at a different pace. Some grow quickly in the Christian faith. Others grow slowly. And important thing is that we keep growing and going, even when it gets tough. You see, my friend, God has not promised that our race would be easy. No, no. He has promised us that when our race is finished, there's a reward awaiting us if we have stayed in the race and refused to give up no matter how difficult it gets. And while we're in the race, there will be some ups and there's going to be some downs. In other words, sickness and death and disappointments will confront each of us at some time or another. But we must remember God can use our difficulties to make us a better people. For God is not the author of trouble, but God is the architect who through trouble can design a brand new you. But you see, our usefulness in life is somehow strangely attached to our struggles throughout life. Most of us who care about the fallen have known the pain of defeat, or as well as the thrill of victory. There's a second thing to remember this morning which will keep you in the race when life gets tough. Or you need to keep life's nobler purposes in perspective. You see, when life presses upon you, the temptation is to see only the immediate and to forget the ultimate. Come here, Job. When Job was going through his troubles, he didn't give in. He stayed in the race. In the spirit, you can hear, I heard him say, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. Said, I will maintain mine own ways before him, because I know God will order my steps in his word. He'll order your steps in his word. You see, some people are farsighted, and they can only see things at a distance better than things close up. Others are farsighted, and they can see things up close, but they have trouble seeing those things which are at a distance. But under the duress of difficulty, many of us become nearsighted, or we see too well the problems at hand best, and we lose sight of all the possibilities which lie ahead. This tells me that if we know why we are in the race, then we'll stay in the race. And while we're in the race, I realize every now and again, wife is not going to agree with you. Husband is not going to agree with you. Children may sass you, but stay on in the race. Continue to love one another. And lastly, my friends, you need to keep your eyes fixed on the prize. Keep your eyes fixed on Jesus and never look back. Oh, we need to look unto Jesus because he is the author and the finisher of our faith. You see, in track and field, if a runner is to win the race, he or she must keep his or her eyes firmly fixed on the finish line. If not, the race may be lost. So keep going. Don't get sidetracked or distracted. Oh, keep looking unto Jesus who stands at the end of life's race, winning to crown you with victory and honor. And I know I'm right about it because the Apostle Paul stayed in the race with his eyes fixed on Jesus. And as he was approaching the finish line one day, headed down the Nero's chopping block, tell me he sat down and he wrote a letter to Timothy, telling Timothy he needed to stay in the race. He said, now I'm ready to be offered, and my departure is at hand. He said, but I fought a good fight, I finished my course, and I've kept the faith. Henceforth is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, not to me on that the righteous judge shall give me on that day, not to me only, but to all of those that believe in his appearing. What he was only saying, that this race that he had run is not going to be given unto him, but if you were to stay on course, if you were to continue to hold fast to God's unchanging hand, if you were to go forth, tell men and women, boys and girls, that Jesus is the Christ, if you were to go forth and let others know that Jesus, him, you're going to keep your the sixth until the ninth hour, it was Jesus who laid on Calvary's cross beam with nails in his hands, with nails in his feet. It was Jesus who cried out, Father, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. That's all right. Tell me he died. They placed him in a borrowed tomb. He slept well there all night, Friday night and all night, Saturday night. But he wanted us to keep our eyes on him. So early, early Sunday morning, he got up with all power entrusted in the palm of his hand. Says, oh death, where is thy sting? Oh grave, where is your victory? I'm he which was dead, but now I'm alive, and I'm alive forevermore, because I have some followers down there who's going to keep their eyes on the prize. And as long as they keep their eyes on me, no matter what come against them, they will begin to know that I'm not going to forsake them. I'm not going to leave them. I don't care whether it's sickness or death. I'll just hold fast to God's unchanging hand. And when this old life's over, you'll be able to hear a welcome voice saying, servant of God, well done. You've been faithful over a few things. Come on up high, and I'll make you a ruler over many, because you kept your eyes on the prize. You stayed in the race, and you didn't leave. Just continue to trust me for all things. And that's what we got to do, church. We got to trust God for all things, no matter what comes our way. Every now and then, we're going to have trouble. We're going to have heartaches. Things not going to go our way all the time. But if we just continue to call on his holy name and just remember and just you just say, Lord, I'm your child, and you are my father. Come on and see about me. And he'll come see about you. He'll keep you in the race. He'll keep you in the pathway of life forevermore. I will trust in the Lord. I will trust.
This is the time to come. If you want to move your letter from another church
and become affiliated with the First Union under the Fuske Island, this is the time to come. You may come because we are all in this together. And the, believe me, the pastor, the members, even myself, he was more than glad to just continue to work with anyone who wants to come and become a part of the First Union Baptist Church. Because you see, the church is not going to save us, but it gives us an indication of where we need to be. In other words, when we study God's word, then God's word comes to us. Because you see, Christ is the head of the church. And knowing that he's the head of the church, then we need to come so that we become affiliated, become blessed with his word, and begin to live by his word and do his commandments. I will trust, make it see, in the Lord.
General and I had a conversation before the service started that said, we're just going to preach until the sun shines. And since the rain has stopped and the sun is shining, we can conclude our services. So would you please stand for the benediction? Dear church, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of his Holy Spirit rest, abide, and remain in each and every one of you. And in so doing, may he grant you that amazing capacity to go forth from here and to truly love your neighbor as yourself. And the church all said,
Amen.
You have entered to worship. Now, church, go out to love and serve the Lord, and may you all have a truly blessed week.
Amen.